How's this for a tourist photo? Marketing, right? And you should have seen the wave that came after. But anyway, Aaron Agrimson, who's known far and wide for his wreck diving, ran a trip with his group, the Dirty Dozen, to Truk in December, is running trips to Bikini over the next 2 years or 3 years.
At least 3 years, yes.
Over 2019, 20, and 21. I think 19 is sold out, and there's just a couple of spots in 20, so you're out to 21 already.
But
2020 is sold out, so you're out to 2021 at this point. Maybe I should sign up for that. And he has traveled far. He lives in Egypt.
Yeah, I reside in South Sinai.
Resides in South Sinai in Egypt. So all the way from the Middle East is Aaron Agrimson.
Hello, can you hear me? Great. Hello everybody. My name is Aaron Agrimson. I'm from Iceland.
Sorry.
And I'm going to be talking to you guys about Bikini Atoll mostly. Before I do that, I just want to say a very heartfelt thank you to Mark and Renata for hosting me this weekend. There is no way I could have been here if it wasn't for these guys, so thank you very, very much. So, the topics we're going to be touching on tonight is, you know, how does someone end up in Bikini? That's something I get asked quite a lot. Because that's very, you're at the end's road, pretty much. And how did you do it when you're 32? There are a couple of ways of doing it, which I'll take you through. I'll take you through a short personal journey. And then I'll talk to you a little bit about Truk Lagoon, because Truk Lagoon is the gateway drug to Bikini. That's how I got hooked.
Really?
Yeah, exactly. And then we'll touch on Operation Crossroads. I can't go into a very extensive history lesson right now, but we'll just touch on the basics and how it worked. And then I can tell you a little bit about how do you get there, how do you do this, because this destination is pretty much as remote as it gets. And therefore, just traveling there can take up to 50, 60 hours. So it's a hell of a mission to do, and I'm just going to try and make it a little bit more simple for you guys to think about if you want to sign up, if you want to go. And then I'll talk about some of the wreck highlights, some of the best wrecks we have in Bikini. And then we have questions, you know, more than happy, if you guys want to ask me anything during the presentation, just, you know, raise your hand, more than happy to keep it interactive. We get started. So my personal journey into wreck diving started with a project that's very close to my heart, and it comes to America, actually. It's an expedition called Expedition Hamilton, which we conducted in 2011, I think. In 2013, and the guy that you have on your $10 bill, Alexander Hamilton, he had a Coast Guard cutter named after him, which sank, was the first American ship to sink as World War II started, by a Nazi submarine off the coast of Iceland. Well, I'm Icelandic, okay? So Paul Allen is out there, the late Paul Allen was out looking for it, and because there was an oil slick in the area where it had sunk, and the Coast Guard had kind of identified it as Hamilton. There's 26 people still on this ship today at 300 feet. So Paul Allen went and scouted it with his submarines and all his stuff, but there was never a personal identification of a human actually being down there and seeing it. That's where we came in. So Team Blue Immersion, that's a team of us four here. So you have Eric Brown, he was part of the Thai Cave Rescue, if you know. And then you have Jonas Samuelson and then Chris Haslam. So what we basically did is we went there first time to just positively identify the ship. But then we got in touch with the families of the fallen men, and they started sending us a lot of letters and a lot of pictures, you know, groups of people out in the fields holding signs saying thank you and all this stuff. I went to North Carolina when they christened the new Hamilton, and I met the great-great-great-grandson of Alexander Hamilton. Like, it's been intense. And it turned out to be so much more than just diving wrecks. You know, you're directly affecting people's lives. So that was kind of where wreck diving took a hold of me as a person. Because as we all know, we all love the underwater ocean. I'm quite a geek, so I got into technical diving, right? But I love the reefs, I love the caves. But wrecks was just a natural kind of digression of that. So I have a documentary that I made about this project. It's quite long though, it's 25 minutes. So what I'll do is I'll just show you the very last scene where we put the memorial plaque on, and you can get a feel of how intense that was. Let's see if it works. You good?
19 guy.
There we go. How can I turn up volume?
Number four?
Okay. Let's see here.
Inventory of helium in the hospital. That's a true story.
Yeah.
There was no helium in Iceland. They stand in the unbroken line of patriots who have dared to die, that freedom might live and grow and increase blessings. Freedom lives, and though it, they live in a way that humbles the undertakings of most men.
Somewhere. I can maybe share a link.
Yes,
to
that
would be great.
Yeah, absolutely. So maybe turn this guy up number one for the mic, right? Yeah. Can you hear me in the back?
Yes.
Okay, great. So that was my introduction to serious wreck diving, and it was very challenging. On that day, our budget only allowed to rent the boat for one day. We had used the entire helium supply of Iceland. That's not a joke. We did rob the hospitals. They couldn't operate MRIs after that. So we had one chance. We had the families, you know, that are from the fallen men, obviously, on the phone waiting to see if we did this. So you can imagine how your heart is kind of racing a little bit once you do it. But we managed, and then that was incredible start to serious wreck diving. Anyway, so this is our dive center that we had in Dahab, which we operated for 5 years between 2012 and 2016, 17. No, that's in Dahab in Egypt. Nice and warm. I'm done with that. So we decided to sell that. We only made a deal. We would have the company for 3 years. We ended up having longer, but then we sold it off. And then I was like a lost puppy. I just went traveling for a year, spent a lot of money, became broke, and then called a friend and asked for a job. And that's kind of how the whole adventure started. So this is Master Lube Works, or Truck Master. The owners of this company used to have beers with me in a beach bar like 10 years ago when they had one boat. Now they have 13. So I called him up, you know, with my predicament. I was a bit lost. And he's like, dude, we have a boat and truck that kind of needs someone to run it for a couple of months. Do you want to go? I'm like, yeah. A pretty obvious answer there. I gave my house to a friend of mine and said, I'll be back in 3 months. I came back 15 months later. So I went to truck and I stayed there for over a year. And I cannot begin to describe to you what an incredible experience that was. And the dives that I've done rank very much so of the best of my life, hands down. I know we're not here to talk too much about truck, but I do have a little clip that might interest you. I don't know if you know National Geographic's One Strange Rock, hosted by Will Smith. They were doing a series with us, so we did the segment on truck. So actually have it here, and we can pull it up.
So I think, yeah, you go down the King Mast, and then you jump into the third hole. Okay, well, you know, I've done the checklist. I've got the comms ready, so good luck.
That shot took 30 takes, and I was upside down, thrown over the side.
One of the biggest graveyards of ships in the world. Around 50 Japanese boats and over 250 aircraft were sunk here by American forces during the Second World War. Some were blown up with torpedoes. Others were bombed. It might seem like useless junk now, but for some kinds of life, it's a perfect home. All that energy that was poured in to make the vessels of the war is there waiting to be released. Rusticles look like stalactites, and they are part metal and part microbes. Microbes extract the chemical energy from the metal, using it to grow and reproduce.
To us, iron is just a metal. But for these microbes, it's food. The rusticle is crawling with billions of happy bacteria, all chomping on an all the iron you can eat underwater buffet.
The first creatures on Earth were microbes. And in the future, when all human life is gone, bacteria will still be there doing their business.
The segment we did with National Geographic, fantastic footage and an amazing project to be a part of. And this is kind of where I started to get serious about Truk and think about how I could share this amazing place with my friends. Because The Dirty Dozen is an old Lee Marvin war movie, if you've seen it. You know, it's me and the captain of the Truk Master were both very passionate wreck divers, and we were kind of watching the movie, having a beer, and we're like, yeah, we should invite some friends, go to 12 wrecks, let's call it the Dirty Dozen. So I just wanted to invite my best friends to go on a good time, because I've been having the time of my life for a year, and I honestly just wanted to share the adventure. So I just made a one-off trip. That then turned into 17 in 1 year. clearly, people enjoyed the concept. But what I do have now is another just short video from, I think, the first trip we did. With just the people talking about their experience in Truk.
Wrecks are as good as everyone says. They are extremely well preserved, and the number of artifacts on each wreck is just mind-blowing.
A friend of mine once described it. He said, if Disney did wrecks, Disney had made a blockbuster here. It's fantastic.
Me, I wasn't actually thinking about all the marine life that goes around the wrecks.
It's really difficult to pick a favorite wreck here. There are so many, and they all have many great features that stand out.
Once we exit the water, we are immediately handed our gear off, we are helped out of the water, and we are right away given a cold juice of some sort, which is so nice.
Basically, there's no other place like it. The wrecks we've got here, the variety of the wrecks, there's nowhere else in the world what has this.
My favorite wreck is the Aipapumaru. Imagine the sheer size of this ship at a depth which is not attainable for recreational divers. The possibility of us diving it on this trip for such a long bottom time with all the logistics we had makes it very special.
Most of the operations in truck don't go to certain wrecks, and these are these hidden gems in the lagoon that are very rarely visited. We came up with a unique itinerary which we decided we wanted to show my dearest friends. It only started as a trip for close friends to come and join on, but it's now turned into a fully fledged concept.
Nowhere else can you get so close to history and get such a real feel for history as when you're diving the wrecks in Truk Lagoon.
I invite you to come and join us on these unique wreck itineraries. Right. So at this point, I'd stopped working at the boat. I think my dog at home missed me. It was time to go home. But the boat was moving on, and we were prepping for Bikini Atoll. And this was the first time a commercial operation has been operating there for 10 years. So it was an enormous logistical challenge to get that organized. But in 2018, we set out for the first season. So now we can start getting into why you're here, Bikini. If we look at the history brought up to Operation Crossroads. Obviously, you all remember Pearl Harbor and what happened in 1941. And if a fact about that is, you know, when Admiral Yamamoto launched the attack on Pearl Harbor, he did that from the Nagato. And the Nagato is one of the ships that is in Bikini. So when you go there, you can literally go into the bridge where Admiral Yamamoto launched the attack on Pearl Harbor and therefore changed world history. You can stand in that exact spot. So as the Americans got into World War II and into the Pacific Theater, you can see kind of the route that went and came up to Japan, where they finally defeated them and then used nuclear weapons for the first time. A very little known fact about this, and the only reason I dug it up is because I had no internet, I had no Facebook, no beer, no nothing for a whole year. So I had plenty of time to read. And I found out that during the Manhattan Project, in 1943, on May 5th, their committee had decided to drop the first atomic bomb in Truk Lagoon, of all places, because they wanted to test it on ships. But obviously they didn't. They went to Hiroshima instead, and Nagasaki, and therefore had that happened, had they decided to do that, maybe Bikini would have never been here. You never know, because they already tested it on ships, right? So that's a kind of small known fact about how they used the nuclear weapons in that aspect. So yeah, if we have a look, there's Hiroshima, and the yield of that bomb is 10 kilotons, so just to keep that in mind. Then we obviously have the Japanese surrender. It was announced on August 15th, 1945, and formally signed on September 2nd. Obviously a huge event in world history. And this is now where the Americans, after winning the Second World War, got something called a war prize. So you take the capital ships from the Axis powers and you acquire them. So the Americans were in hands of some of the biggest battleships that their enemies had, including other the Prinz Eugen of the Nazis, the Nagato from the Japanese, and others. Okay. So what's interesting about that is that is Operation Crossroads and that is Bikini Atoll, because the Americans decided that now that, well, and this is only my personal opinion, is after winning the Second World War, they wanted to send a message, a very clear message to not mess with us again. And I don't blame them, to be honest. And how they did that is that they took half of the cinema equipment in the world at that time, and they took 42,000 staff, 115 support vessels, and 95 target vessels, and brought them to Bikini Atoll. And they filmed that thing. They filmed that explosion. They invited dignitaries from all over the world to come witness it in person to show them that they have the technology to literally evaporate anything. So I think that kind of cemented their stance on world domination at the time, or world power, let's say. And what I have next is a little clip that I assembled and edited, which is quite recent, actually. I think it's only a year old since I edited it, and it has declassified footage that they had just released at the time. This is a clip that's about Operation Crossroads as such and of the bomb, which is very impressive, as you will see now. I don't know about you, but it still gives me the heebie-jeebies every time I watch it. It's very impressive. So now, yeah, let's get down to it. What is Operation Crossroads? Well, you just seen a video of the Baker test, which was the underwater test. So I actually just found out about this when I was making this presentation, but the names of the actual devices were Gilda and Helen, which I find quite entertaining. There was a very femme fatale theme of the whole operation. And another little known fact is that I'm sure all of you, at least the women, have a bikini at home, right? So do you know why it's called a bikini? You're about to find out, because the designer behind the bikini, he watched the tests and he wanted to introduce an explosive garment, which he then called the bikini. So little known fact about that. Yeah, there you go. So the whole like operation has a lot of those kind of undertones, which are quite entertaining. But there were two tests in Operation Crossroads. It was initially planned 3, but the last one was cancelled. So the, one of them was aerial, called Able, and the other test was Baker, which was detonated at, in feet, it's about 60 feet, I think, underwater. So like you can see here, the target fleet was 95 vessels. I think that's equivalent to the 6th largest navy at the world at the time. So one hell of a test. 150 vessels in the support fleet, organizing it with 42,000 people as staff. And like I said, half of the world cinema equipment. Now, where is it? Bikini is situated in the Marshall Islands, in the middle of the Pacific. So we're going to be talking about, well, as you can see right there in the top corner, that's where Bikini is. When you'll be flying into the Marshall Islands and to Bikini, you actually land in Kwajalein. That's a U.S. Army base, and that from there is where you take the boat and you steam to Bikini. We'll get more on that later. Here is Bikini, and this is the area over there. It's the target area where they assembled the 95 ships. And here is a picture of the less known detonation, Able, a.k.a. Gilda, June 30, 1946. Remember when I told you Hiroshima had 10 kilotons of yield? Well, the Able, they have 23,000 tons of TNT, or 23 kiloton yield, so over double the performance, let's say. It created a 500 meter fireball. I think that's like almost half a mile or something. And it started fires about 2 miles away. And it sank 5 ships, as you will see a list of here. So here's the detonation area. It did sink the Gillam, the Sakowa, the Carlisle, the Anderson, and the U.S. Lamson. So a variety of transport vessels, destroyers, a Japanese cruiser, and a transport vessel. And then you have the list here of the seriously damaged wrecks. The next test was Baker, a.k.a. Helen of Bikini, and was launched on July 24, 1946. And as you can see, it's quite more dramatic how this bomb performed. The same performance, but underwater, created a 5.5 Richter scale earthquake, a 30 meter tsunami, and evaporated 4 tons of sea and sand in an instant. And it sank a total of 9 ships. So here was the target area for that bomb. And as you can see, we have an amphibious ship, LSM-60, we have the battleship Arkansas, pilotfish submarine, we have the USS Saratoga, an aircraft carrier, we have an oiler, another Nagato, the battleship was sunk there as well, and a few other submarines and a dry dock vessel. So clearly a lot more efficient way of sinking a fleet was using an underwater device. Here's a picture, that famous picture again. If you look over here, that is a battleship. That is the Arkansas standing up in the air. Can you believe it? Which is just phenomenal, the amount of power that's exerted to lift a ship like that up in the sky. The diameter is, well, 1,000 feet. Wow. Which is, you know, just unfathomably unbelievable. Oh yeah, this was the guy behind the bikini, by the way. And next up, now that we looked at a bit of the historical background of the test, very simplified version of it, I'm going to show you a little video that I made from our first trip to Bikini. Yeah, with a few, like how it looks like today, let's say. Let's see if it works.
Bikini Atoll so far has been absolutely off the charts. It is a kind of a lifelong dream to come to this part of the world again. I was here in Truk Lagoon about 10 years ago, and to revisit it now with some enhanced skill sets like the rebreather, it opens up a whole new world of opportunity. Being able to explore these wrecks further than I thought I could in the past.
Every time you stand after a long dive, long vehicle, the staff and crew make you with a smile and lots of drinks and water. Fantastic experience.
If you feel like joining us next time on the Critical Experiment in 2019 through to 2021, feel free to contact us via the website, email, or on Facebook.
Right, okay, so that's kind of how Bikini looks like today. That was a GUE style tip.
Why do you think there was a hard hat down there? What's
that? Oh, they left them there on purpose. There's two of them, two different ones. Actually, I think there's a third one as well. One of them is quite easy to get to. The other two, not so much. The Saratoga is an incredible beast to dive. And you could dive it for years and years and years, and it would not be enough. The fact of the matter of it is, it's a 39,000 ton vessel. So the best analogy I can give you is, if you imagine an abandoned shopping mall that's 4 or 5 stories high, right? You walk inside, there's bound to be hundreds of stores on each level. That's pretty much how it feels like when you go inside, except it's dark and it's dusty. And there's just hundreds of rooms and level after level after level. And the Saratoga, you can find some incredible things inside the Saratoga because they sank it with lots of stuff on there, like war ready. So yeah, very much to see. But I'll get back to that in a little bit. If you look at this today, this is Bikini, how it looks like now, and that's where the target zone was for the tests. So, let's get a little bit more into it. If you want to go, I'm going to tell you about it right now. So when you go, and you guys are super lucky actually, because you're Americans, you can fly very easily from, I wouldn't recommend going from Guam because you'd be going in the wrong direction, but if you go from Honolulu, you're going to go on the infamous Island Hopper, which will take you to Kwajalein, which is where you need to go in the Marshall Islands. I can tell you that you do not want to go on this airplane from Guam, because I do it sometimes, and it is a lot of stops, it's a lot of up and down, and it's just an absolute nightmare of a flight, to be honest with you. But if you go from Honolulu, it's just one stop, really, and you're there. And I've cracked a bit of a code with United, because they have a monopoly on it. And I was getting a little bit annoyed paying $2,500 every time I had to go. That's how much the flight was for me, on average. What you guys can do right now, because your credit card companies are going crazy, is that you sign up for that Visa card and it actually expires tonight. But I'm sure they have some other offers coming. They will give you 75,000 miles with United if you spend, I think, $5,000 in the first 3 months. Well, guess what? My trips are just about that money. And a flight to Bikini return is 70,000 miles. So, hey, you get a $2,500 flight ticket for free, effectively. So no matter what you do when you book your flight to Bikini, use the miles system. You can even just buy the miles off United because it will cost you less than $2,500. I can guarantee it. You can get it for half price, easy. Because that's what I'm doing now. So yeah, definitely a good tip there. Okay, so once you land in Kwajalein, you are then greeted by American military personnel because it is a military base. And then they take a very good look at your stuff, throw you onto a ferry paid by the US government, thank you very much, for free, and kick you off the island immediately to the neighboring island of Ibai, where you will stay at Hotel Ibai, which is the only hotel in Ibai, a very charming one too, and there you will wait. I say that because anybody that comes on my trips, I usually ban them from arriving the same day. Well, they can maybe with Bikini because you have some time to rest because you have a long steam to Bikini. But the jet lag is so bad from trips like this that I don't let people get on unless they have a couple of days rest to acclimatize for safety mainly. So right, we pick you up on this Ibai Island, and that's, from there you take a 24-hour steam to Bikini, which is quite long. So that's it there. You land in Kwajalein, and you're doing this distance here. Well, yeah, it's about 23 to 30 hours, depending on conditions. It's not all bad, though. It can be quite a pleasant ride driving over there. Quite beautiful. So once you get to Bikini, now it's time to talk about the important stuff, the diving, the wrecks. Today, Bikini has 21 wrecks. But of the 21, 10 are the ones that are of your interest. I don't think you've traveled that long and spent that much money to go look at a dry dock vessel. So the 10 main wrecks are here on the map, which I'll talk about the bare highlights of them and show you some pictures. But the depth is 45 to 55 meters, which is somewhere around 150 to 200 feet, I think, which is slightly deeper than Truk. So if anybody thinks you need to be a technical diver to go to Truk Lagoon, you're wrong. 70% of the wrecks are within recreational limits. I had open water divers on my boat. Everybody can dive and enjoy that place. Bikini, however, is just that deeper where you kind of have to get into technical certifications to be able to enjoy it to its potential, if that makes sense. So if we start looking at some of the wrecks, we have the Prince Eugen, and that's actually a wreck that you dive on the way to Bikini because it actually survived the test in Bikini and then it was being towed back to Kwajalein where it then sank. And this is quite a fascinating wreck, 17,000 tons, heavy class cruiser. It served with the Bismarck, surrendered to the Royal British Navy, and then transferred to the United States as a war prize. And then, so when you're kind of leaving Kwajalein, we stop by the Prince Eugen and dive it. And when you get there, this is what you see. One of the propellers sticking out of the water. And I get goosebumps every time I see that because it's just incredible. And then once you get down, you have big guns. You have, you know, lots of good penetration. However, a common feature with battleships is that they're usually upside down. And that's due to the weight of the guns that are sitting on top. So they just kind of go turtle every time. So being inside can be trickier than regular wreck diving on the battleship especially, but there's still possibilities. But yeah, an absolutely stunning wreck and definitely a very big highlight of Bikini. And that's what you start with on the way there, or do it on the way back, depends. And then we have the Imperial Japanese Navy Nagato, which is a 32,000 ton battleship. It was his Admiral Yamamoto's fortress, where he did launch the attack on Pearl Harbor. So obviously quite a significant ship in terms of history. So if we have a look, I call this kind of like the underwater Stonehenge kind of vibe, you know, because you have four of these propellers sticking out. It's just incredibly impressive how big they are. So we have the bridge, and here are some of the guns. These guys are unbelievable. There's, I think Richard Lundgren is inside the bridge there. Yeah, so few shots from the Nagato, a fantastic wreck that everybody needs to dive at least once if you get the chance. And then we have my personal favorite, the USS Saratoga. Now, in truck, when I lived there for 15 months, I had one mission. And that was to go to the biggest wreck in the lagoon, go inside at the stern, and leave at the bow without seeing sunlight. That took me 1 year to figure out. And that ship is 10,000 tons. This is 39,000 tons. So I don't think I'll be cracking this one anytime soon. But she is my absolute favorite. Commissioned in 1927, she's actually a converted aircraft carrier. And I came here to New York, this is actually where we first met Renata, to research your aircraft carriers, because I wanted to see one in real life before I actually went and dove it. So I went to the Intrepid, right here off New York, and I went for a tour. To my dismay, the first thing the tour guide told me is, well, Intrepid is nothing like the Saratoga. I'm like, really? Well, why? Well, because the Saratoga is a converted battleship. So it was a battleship before it entered service as an aircraft carrier. So the layout inside, going into the engine room, all this stuff, it wasn't going to help me one bit to see it on the Intrepid. Which then made it just more challenging, which is also fun. But yeah, an absolutely phenomenal wreck. 270 meters in length. It's no small beast to play with. And like I said, they left them more ready. There's planes, there's bombs, there's... It's full of stuff.
Why did we sink our own boat?
Well, she was decommissioned. I mean, the first time she was launched was in 1918. So she was old, the poor lady. I guess they decided to put her down.
Put her out of
remission. Yeah. So a fascinating wreck with a lot of good stuff to see. Yeah, that's kind of the view as you kind of pass into it. Here's the view from the deck. The famous guns on top. Very, very impressive. This is a shot inside the bridge. Which is surprisingly small. You'd never think they'd be that small on that big of a wreck. And they peep out these tiny little holes, and you're like, really? Okay. Here's some of the penetration. There is a permanent guideline down there. Quite old, fragile. We are looking at installing a new one. But this wreck is endless. And there are many places which haven't been explored yet. And one thing I was always wondering, because sometimes I came to a dead end and there'd be a locked door and stuff, but sometimes there wasn't. But it didn't look like they were open. It looked like they were pried open. And I think they used to do that. They took a crowbar and they literally, when the guides were getting bored, they started to open up rooms. And that's kind of what has happened, I think. Here's a shot inside my favorite room, inside the dentist office. And I swear to God, you could almost have an appointment there. It looks so pristine, honestly. And it's just unbelievable, that place. Very, very beautiful. Here's a shot. This is Global Underwater Explorers co-founder Richard Lundgren with one of the Mark V helmets, which this one is very easy to see, actually. Here's a shot from the dry suit room. So there's a compressor there, hoses, the whole thing. Quite old dry suits.
These new seals.
Yeah, and these new seals. yeah, so Hellcats as well.
Oh, man.
Yeah, you'll find these on the Saratoga, inside the wreck, and on the outside. Not as many as you could see, because there's quite a severe depression in the flight deck, and that has crushed a lot of the Hellcats, unfortunately. It is starting to become a very old wreck now, but here's a picture of one of the All cats on the outside. Then we also have the USS Arkansas, American 29,000 ton battleship, hosted some of your presidents under convoys, I think Woodrow Wilson and William Taft, deployed in Omaha Beach, received 4 battle stars, sunk by the Baker Blast. Here's some of our favorite shots from there, then some big guns. Always enjoy this picture. But yeah, again, upside down, just due to the nature of the vessel. And then we have USS Anderson, American destroyer, 10 battle stars, sunk by the Able Blast. Cruised with the USS Wasp, which was just found like very recently, wasn't it? Yeah, so that was kind of a fun fact. Obviously a bit of a smaller vessel being a destroyer, but a very, very enjoyable wreck nonetheless, with some very interesting things on it. USS Lamson, another destroyer that's kind of a highlight for me, launched in the wake of Pearl Harbor, 5 battle stars. What's good about this wreck, it displays very well the damage that nuclear explosions cause, because that hull is terribly twisted and damaged. So that's very interesting to see the effects of nuclear weapons with these ships. I think I have a few images from there as well. But yeah, again, this is one of my favorite pictures. It kind of encapsulates Bikini very well, because you have, you know, a shark over there, guns over there, just everything everywhere. And it's just so much fun. And that's maybe one thing, I totally forget to mention the marine life. I mean, I think the first time I went on the Saratoga with Richard Lundgren, my first dive in Bikini, after a 2-hour penetration, we're coming out, you know, giggling like tiny schoolgirls in our loop. So happy. And as we're swimming over the flight deck of the aircraft carrier, and we have, I don't know, an hour decoy or something, a 4-meter, what's that, like over 10 feet long tiger shark comes along on the flight deck and starts swimming around us, and you're just like, I can't believe this is happening. But yeah, abundance of marine life, turtles, rays, sharks, you name it. Obviously, I was impressed by how many sharks are there, actually, because they're completely left alone. Nobody fishes there, nobody does anything, so literally shark soup you will find there. And then we have, yeah, this is one of the submarines, USS Apogon, was in the Mickey Finn's Wolfpack in the Second World War, 5 battle stars, sank 3 Japanese vessels, sits perfectly upright, so it's a very kind of standard model of diving a submarine. And sunk by the Able Blast as well. Here are some highlight images from there as well. Some big props.
Was it on the surface when it blew up?
Yeah, it was on the surface when it was blown up, and then it sank. Yeah, absolutely. So the thing about Bikini is, you know, you're flying for about 30 hours to get there. You do another 30 hours on the boat to sail to get there. The number one thing on my mind and yours should be safety and how to perform all these dives safely, because these are some hard run times we're doing. We're doing around 5 hours in the water every day, you know, 2-3 hours at 150 to 200 feet. So we decide halfway through the trip, we take most of the day off, actually, and we go to the Bikini Island. And we have a barbecue. And the thing is, you know, there used to be people there. They were evacuated for the tests and they could never return, unfortunately, due to radiation. There are 3 people there now as caretakers, and they only do 3-month shifts in and out. But we're allowed to go on there, have a barbecue, have a look around. Just don't, you know, drink the local coconut water, any agriculture. Don't do that. It's not good for you. still contaminated too. To this day. But going on the island was an unsurprising highlight of my personal experience, because they had a dive center there as well. It was operating over 10 years ago. And when it closed down, they had to leave in a hurry. I think they were stranded there for 2 weeks before they could leave. So when they left immediately. So when you go in there now, it's like going through a time machine. I go into their briefing room, the last briefing is still on the whiteboard. You go into the compressor room, all the tools are up there, everything's there, BCDs, wrecked, the whole thing. It was just left. So it's like you're in this kind of time machine when you're on the island. It's very, very surreal, but also very, very beautiful. So yeah, we bring our stuff there, throw a barbecue, and good times all around. Yeah. So yeah, that's Bikini today, and it's an incredible experience. I've been very fortunate to be able to do this, and I hope you will sometime join me, and our team on these fun adventures. One thing I will tell you, and I'll wrap this up, is that I have something for you. And this is where the business side of things comes in, right? National Geographic had to cancel one of their productions with me this year. So I'm sold out until 2020. But they had to cancel one of their Drain the Ocean series, if you've seen those. They were gonna do an episode with me in Bikini. They had to cancel for production reasons. I withheld their deposit, as I will, because it's non-refundable. But I'm not putting it into my pocket. I'm gonna pass on the savings to you guys. So this is the only opening until 2021. The trip is $7,500, and I have now shaven $2,000 off that seat. I think we have 5 or 6 seats left or something like that. So it's first come, first served. We will accommodate you if you wish to come with us. It would be a pleasure. You can see all the inclusions here. In the brochure I have with you there as well, there's lots of information. Online, you can find a PDF that explains everything about my operation. Obviously, I have business cards here I can pass you. You write me a message, and I'll send you all the inclusions. I think that's it for me. Thank you very much for your attention. Hope you had a good evening. If there's any questions. Oh, okay.
Well,